This is the Dean Show. This is the Dean. This is the Dean Show.
This is the Dean Show.
This is the Dean. This is the Dean Show.
Bismillah, alhamdulillah, assalamu alaikum, peace be with you. Thank you for tuning in again to another episode of the Dean Show. So many misconceptions about the fastest growing way of life in the world today, yet most misunderstood. So we're going to be clearing up some of these misconceptions. Islam calling you to blow up yourself, blow up innocent people. It was created by a man in the desert. And you know what, the Antichrist and all this other phony baloney nonsense that we're going to be addressing here on the Dean Show with Imam John Yahya. We'll be right back.
This is the Dean, the Dean Show.
This is the Dean Show.
This is the Dean Show. This is the Dean Show.
Back here on the Dean Show, Imam John.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam. Rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Now, peace be with you. And we've done a show with you in the past. People can go to thedeanshow.com to hear your story. You're a born-again Christian, before that a Catholic, and then you were in the agnostic phase. You were like, you know what, hey, you know, I'm not digging this, but, you know, I'm going towards what, you know, what's next, agnosticism. I kind of believe, I don't, what's out there. You read the Quran, verbatim word of God. You've even memorized, it's a miracle of the Quran, that people have memorized it, and you are not even a native speaking Arab, but you've memorized this entire book. Is this true?
This is a blessing that I was given, a very, also a responsibility to keep that up. But yes, I was given that blessing.
Now, was your dad and mom half Arab or something?
No.
Pure bred American.
Yeah, born and raised. Yeah.
Now, that's a phenomenon. You're an American who didn't grow up speaking Arabic, but you've memorized. That's one of the miracles of this book, the Quran. It's a living miracle that people, if they're searching the truth, they can come analyze it. And they'll see that this can't come from Muhammad or any group of men or aliens, space Martians, the devil, as some say. That's, yeah, you know, yes. This comes, they'll realize, like you did, that this is from the creator of all that exists. Mm-hmm. Is that what you realized?
Oh, naturally.
Now, let's start off with it, because time is short. Let's start off because we're talking about misconceptions. Mm-hmm. Many people have misconceptions about this way of life. That's from the creator. It's not made by a group of men or the last and final messenger of Muhammad. But for those that believe that Muhammad concocted this.
Yes.
What do you got to say?
You see, the Crusades were historically written, and they're known to be, after Muslims gained prominence and dominance in the political arenas, miraculously toppling the Persian and the Byzantium empires, basically taking a third of the civilized world into its realm, the Catholic or the Christian Roman group decided we need to start waging wars and to take back and kill all of these Muslims. And by the way, during that time, Muslims and Jews were living together. And as a matter of fact, when these crusaders came, these Christians, by the command of the Pope, according to his understanding that he's receiving a decree from God to go spread bloodshed in the name of God, as they believe, who is Jesus and the Father and the Son. So when this happened, there was this, of course, enmity. And so Muslims and Jews fought together, defending their lands and everything. And even some of the local Christian priests and people preferred the Muslim just rule over the rule of the Roman Empire. So after that happened, the Crusades did not stop there. There formed a group called Orientalists. They started to look into history and write it from their perspective in order to discredit Islam in the intellectual arena, to try to develop a theory as to how we can somehow prove or at least make our own evidence to make Islam seem like obviously some false pagan, to an extent that they claimed that we worshiped the moon, they said that we worshiped pagan gods, that we said we worshiped Muhammad. They tried to cast onto us the name Muhammadians. And they wrote this in their books in England and France and Germany and Poland and later Portugal and Spain and elsewhere. So part of that claim or that attack was to say that Muhammad, peace be upon him, was, they admit, they read history, he was a good young man with good morals and manners, was not evil, was not corrupt, was not even known to lie. His people called him As-Sadiq al-Amin, the truthful, trustworthy man that they would go to when they would get in corrupt disputes. But at some point they said he got this, they have two stories. And it's interesting, and you should all read Gary Miller's analysis of this. It was a great Revert Muslim.
Gary Miller, they can go online, Google, and just put
Amazing
Gary.
Quran, Gary Miller, about Prophet Muhammad. Mm-hmm. And so one group says Muhammad traveled. In the narrations of history, we have two trips. Once when he was a young boy, he went with Abu Talib, his uncle, to the area of Syria, where there is a prevalence of Christian people. One of the narrations which Muslims often try to use as proof, but many of the Muslim scholars of hadith took issue with the hadith, says that there was indeed some sort of a priest or monk that was amazed by Muhammad and was telling him about prophethood. And so they're concocting the story that Muhammad spent time learning about the previous messages of Christianity and Judaism and so forth. Because obviously in Mecca, those are very rare to find anybody that believes it, much less knows much about it. And so after that one trip when he was 12, then whenever he was 20-something, he went with Khadija, who at that point was just the owner of the caravan he worked for, and then he went there again. So these are two events that narrate that the Prophet Muhammad went with a caravan. Now, on either of these events, nobody narrates that he spent time studying with any priest. The one story from the beginning, when he was 12, right, says that a priest told him, you have the signs of prophethood, or you could be a prophet, and this and that. But there is no discussion that he had long discussions, which you would need to have to form a full book that knows everything about the previous book, right? Especially since you're an illiterate Arab man who doesn't know Aramaic or Assyrian or Greek language, which is what they're speaking over there, a mixture of these three, right? So so that story is totally baseless. For Muslims, we believe it to be blasphemy if someone were to say Muhammad is the founder of Islam. That's blasphemy, right? We believe that God created the creation and made a system that creation will submit to his will. Mm-hmm. And all of creation will do that except for he will call out to creation and offer it the great trust. It's in the end of Surah Al-Ahzab. So he says, who will take the trust or the responsibility of having their own consciousness to know right and wrong and then be responsible for doing the right thing? All of creation said no. Everything, animals, suns, planets, everything communicated to God that we're just going to follow your system that you have designed for us. Atoms, protons, neutrons, electrons, following their course without any disturbance. We're just going to do what you said and be peaceful in that state. Human being by nature said, I believe that I can take this. And this is what our brothers and sisters from humanity, you hear them saying, that they create, that God created man in his image. Obviously, we are not, God is not a human or anything that you can imagine. But his image is more of a metaphor that he has this creative ability to control the environment and do what he wants with it. And he can make decisions and conscious decisions about it. And so having that control is something that human beings amongst all other creation have been blessed with. So when he sent these prophets, this prophet's message, all of them, was to submit to the will of God. As a matter of fact, in the book of Matthew in the New Testament, Jesus said to a guy who came saying, Master, Master, Lord, Lord, whichever translation you want to take, he said, whoever says to me, Lord, Lord, will not enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of the Father in heaven, metaphorical Father, that God is creator of everything. And so that is, he's clearly teaching, submit to the will of God. It's not just by saying, I'm your Lord or I'm your master as the prophet. You have to do the will of God. So Islam is not something that any human can make up. It is something that God reveals. So going back to Gary Miller, it's interesting because some of the other Orientalists, they looked at the arguments that their predecessors made, that he got full of himself, used some knowledge he got from Syria, and then developed this religion, which is based in the Judeo-Christian tradition. But then they said, but if you read more about his life and his example, he obviously believed that he was the prophet. I mean, when he's staying up all night praying and his feet are cracking from soreness, and Aisha, his wife, God be pleased with her, she says, why are you praying all night? God, you're the prophet. Your sins have been forgiven. If you ever made a mistake in your life, you know, you're clear. You've been given prophethood. And so then he said, shouldn't I be a grateful servant? When he attained power and political dominance, he could have built a palace and had very beautiful women, but never did he do any of this. His life testified to the fact that he truly believed. So then they developed a new theory. Prophet Muhammad was insane. He was crazy. He was talked to by jinns or demons or devils. And so they gave him these ideas, and so he was fooled about this. So now the other argument that you're saying is, basically you're saying that